Guys, I know you have been missing me so much.
I also missed you, Fabio.
Oh, Rexy, you're so sweet. Come here, give me a hug. Oh no, you can't. If you thought we had gotten rid of vowels, well, today it's time to tell you something hard to accept. No, we still have a lot of things to say about vowels. You're still ignorant. Let's say you were 100% ignorant in the beginning, now you're 50%. But still you are. But I can help you come out of the decay of your existence, if you keep watching video number 10. So, are you ready?
Let's start!
That vowels are very important for the phonetic system of the Germanic languages was already clear when we talked about verbs. A lot of verbs, called strong verbs, change their root vowel in order to form the different tenses. So vowels are very important if they are root vowels and consequently stressed. Vowels belonging to other syllables lost their energy over the centuries and they were simplified in all Germanic languages, till the point that, today, in most Germanic languages most of them were completely lost, or, if they survived, they were strongly centralized, which means that people don't make any strong effort in articulating the vowel sounds. They just let the air flow with a looser articulation. If you don't make any effort to produce a clear vowel, like moving your tongue to the front or to the back, what you produce is a central vowel. And the most central vowel is a sound we have already mentioned, and we also said it's usually called schwa. In fact, this is the sound we usually produce when someone asks us a question and we don't know what to answer, and we just take time.
Tommy, I found a pack of cigarettes in your room! Have you started smoking?
No, Mom. I don't smoke. I just deal them.
Oh, okay, it's fine.
Even though most of those unstressed vowels had disappeared, they left some traces of their previous existence in nearby sounds. This is, for example, what happens in the case of the so-called metaphony. I've already covered this topic in a video I made last year for my other channel, Puglia Tour Guide. You can find the link in the description below. What is metaphony? The word comes from the Greek language, from meta, a prefix often connected to the meaning of change, mutation, and phone, which means voice or sound. So what we understand from the word is that we are talking about sounds changing. But this definition is not clear enough, as we have lots of different kinds of sound mutations in all languages, not only Germanic languages. Metaphony takes place when a vowel changes its sound under the influence of another sound, even though the latter is not necessarily adjacent to the former. The sound that influences the other is usually another vowel, or sometimes a semi-vowel, that is a vowel sound behaving as a consonant, like I in English yet, or W in English will. As I told you, in order for this influence to be exerted, the two vowels don't necessarily need to stay in close contact. It might also happen that they appear in two different syllables, which means that other sounds may appear between them without taking part to the mutation. So, imagine you have a person. We will call him Root Vowel. Nah, what kind of name is that? Let's say a Root. She's a girl. And she meets another girl called Desinence Vowel. Nah, I don't like this name either. Let's name her Daisy. Root is a stalker. So the first time they meet, they talk to each other like friends. They like each other. But then Root starts calling her every day, which is a typical behavior for someone who needs attention. Daisy is not stupid. She understands that Root is a toxic person and she also realizes she doesn't give a damn about her and just wants to get rid of her, but she's polite, so she can't tell her to her face. As days go by, Daisy notices with horror that Root starts imitating her voice, dressing like her, talking the same way she does, making the same jokes and stuff like that. Daisy finally understands Root is not just a freak, she's a psychopath. So, in the end, she finds an excuse and disappears. Ruth is shocked by her departure, and she tries to fill the gap left by her. The most instinctive and spontaneous way she can think of is trying to transform herself into Daisy. But she can't, because of course she's not a chameleon. So she becomes something in the middle, retaining features of her original behavior and acquiring at the same time new ones while trying to imitate Daisy.
Wow! I should write a novel about these two characters.
Let's try to explain this with some examples. Have you ever noticed some English words form their plural just modifying their root vowel? Why is the plural form of foot, feet, for example? You have to imagine that the Germanic word was foots in the nominative singular and footis nominative plural. When Germanic people began to concentrate most of the articulatory energy on the root syllable, the vowel E weakened more and more, leading to a dangerous situation. If that vowel finally falls off, it will not be possible to distinguish the singular from the plural form. So before disappearing completely, the desinence vowel attracted the root vowel to its place of articulation. As E is a front vowel, while the root vowel O is a back vowel, pronounced in the rear part of the mouth, this attraction led the root vowel to be pronounced in the front part of the mouth, where also E is articulated. As a result, O turned into the sound U, which is pronounced with rounded lips, a feature you find in O as well, but articulated not in the rear part of the palate, like O, but in the front. In a transitional stage of Northwest Germanic, we have singular foot, final S had already been lost, plural füti, but we are close to the complete loss of the final vowel. After a while, the opposition between singular and plural becomes just foot, füt.
No more ending, we don't need it anymore. The morphological difference is already expressed by the root vowel.
Later, the English language lost the sound ø from its repertoire in favor of e, which is the same sound as before, but with unrounded lips. Singular foot, plural fate, then led to today's foot, feet. We find the same in goose, geese, tooth, teeth, and a few other plural forms. But this phenomenon doesn't only affect that sound. The same mechanism applied to mouse and its plural mice. And metaphony is not only to be found in plural forms, but also in the creation of verbs from nouns. See blood to bleed, food to feed, or in the comparative and superlative forms of old, elder, eldest. And we find this mutation not only in English, but in all languages of the Western and Northern groups. See German Fuß, which means foot, plural Füße, Swedish Fot, plural Fötter, but also German Schlafen, to sleep, which becomes Du schläfst in the second singular person of the present. And do you know what Germans call those two dots on the top of the vowel? Umlaut, which means exactly the same as metaphony, that is sound change.
Metaphony or umlaut is not to be confused with apophony or uplaut, which is the use of different vowels in the root syllable of verbs in order to switch from a tense to the other, like in sing, sang, sung. We have already talked about that in video number 7.
A phenomenon which is similar to metaphony, because it is also based on the influence of a sound on another one which usually precedes, is the so-called breaking. In this case, in order to simplify the transition from a front vowel to a velar sound, people transform the vowel into a diphthong, whereby the second part has a place of articulation which is closer to the velar area of the second sound, that is a back vowel. This happened in Old English when a front vowel preceded some consonants, which were supposed to be articulated using the back part of the oral cavity. For example, which is a laryngeal or glottal sound, h, which is a velar sound, and w, which is labiovelar. Another sound which could cause breaking was u, but only if followed by another consonant. In this case, in fact, the consonant was velarized, which means articulated with the tip of the tongue on the alveolar ridge, but with the back part of the tongue slightly raised towards the soft palate. This happens still today in English, in final position, well, or before consonant, belt. Another sound that could cause vowel breaking was r followed by consonants. We can't be sure what exactly this consonant sounded like in Old English, but we can assume it was usually an alveolar or postalveolar sound, r or r, or maybe a tap consonant, r. We can also assume that this sound, if followed by another consonant, was velarized, maybe in something like r, thus causing vowel breaking. Let's give some examples. The Germanic word for the number 8 has been reconstructed as achto, giving acht in German and achto in Gothic. In Old English, a turns into a, which is a front vowel, causing the introduction of a short rear vocalic sound, maybe a between a and h, giving achta. A similar development gives earth, earth, to be compared with German erde, or half, half. Once again, we have the same tendency still today in some English accents, whereby a short central or back vowel is introduced between front vowel and l, like in fjol. Vowel breaking is to be found in Old Norse and in a northern group as well. See, for example, the word jur, earth, present with similar pronunciations in Nynorsk, Bokmål, Swedish and Danish, or jörð in Icelandic, from Germanic erþó, or the word star from Germanic sternón, which becomes stjarna in Icelandic, stjärne in Norwegian and Danish, skötna in Faroese, and stjärna in Swedish.
Both metaphony and breaking are two different examples of assimilation. And assimilation is a tendency that you can find in all languages in the world, because it's part of our instinct to try to use as less energy as possible by reducing the distance between closed sounds. This means you don't have to be surprised if you find the same phenomena in other languages that apparently have nothing to do with the Germanic languages. So, I think it's enough for today. We have learned so much. Well, you did. I already knew these things. That's it for the moment. See you and behave yourselves.